Here's how to think biblically about transitional fossils. Welcome to Critical Thinking Skin, where we look at how you can think about any faith-challenging message and arrive at a biblical, logical conclusion yourself. I'm Patricia Engler, and today let's continue part two of two videos on so-called transitional fossils, which supposedly represent animals in intermediate stages of evolution. We're at critical thinking check number six, looking at biblical interpretations for fossils. Genesis indicates God created organisms to reproduce according to their kinds, even if there's impressive variation within those kinds. So biblically, we can predict that for any transitional fossil claim, one of three things is probably happening. Scenario one, the fossil represents a specimen from either one kind or another kind, not something in between. For instance, observational science reveals that so-called hominid or ape-man fossils are usually fully ape or fully human. Although museums and textbooks and movies may try to represent ancient humans as more ape-like or ancient apes as more human-like than the bones alone would indicate. Likewise, the linked resources explain how the supposed dino-bird fossil Archaeopteryx was an interesting but unequivocal bird. And Tiktaalik, which allegedly represented an ancestor of land animals, was simply a fish. Scenario 2, the fossil is made of bones from different specimens belonging to separate kinds. This is especially possible if the bones were found in different locations, or even in the case of forgeries. For instance, the infamous Piltdown Man skull was forged from human and orangutan bones. Finally, scenario 3, the fossil represents another separate kind with a mosaic of features resembling those of other organisms and reflecting creatures' shared designer. Platypuses, for instance, have characteristics spanning multiple animal groups. So with these three possibilities in mind, you can look closer at observational science to see if there's more to the transitional fossil story. For instance, linked articles explain how a biblical explanation makes much more sense of the abrupt appearances of many living things and their distinguishing features in the fossil record. In the last episode, I also mentioned that evolutionary dates for rock layers surrounding fossils don't always support a straightforward evolutionary explanation. For example, Tiktaalik is considered younger than fossil footprints of a four-footed animal which supposedly came after Tiktaalik. Evolutionists could speculate that Tiktaalik's ancestors were transitional forms, but the point is, observational science doesn't necessarily match what a straightforward evolutionary scenario would predict. That's why, although textbooks may still show linear diagrams of transitional fossil series, modern evolutionists usually believe that transitional forms follow branching patterns rather than linear sequences. And this is even true of the famous horse and whale fossil series that you still see in a lot of textbooks. And even for the most supposedly straightforward sequences, like the presumed reptile to mammal transition, transitional features don't develop smoothly often as textbooks would suggest. So my own first year biology textbook said this, "The fossil record shows that the unique features of mammalian jaws and teeth evolved gradually over time in a series of steps." The book added, "If all the known fossils in this sequence were arranged by shape and placed side by side, their features would blend smoothly from one group to the next." Actually, geologist John Woodmorappe did arrange these fossils by evolutionary date back in 2001. As his linked research paper concluded, "One of the most striking findings uncovered by this analysis is that the majority of anatomical traits, the ones actually used by evolutionists in the construction of their cladograms, do not show a unidirectional progression towards the mammalian condition. Many mammal-like traits disappeared and reappeared throughout the sequence, and large evolutionary gaps occurred in the few traits that did progress linearly. Crossing those large gaps would require gaining functional new genetic information. So another useful question is, okay, what else would have had to happen for this fossilized creature to transform into another kind? And does observational science support such transformations being possible? Finally, for check number seven, check the logic, we can identify circular reasoning in arguments that transitional fossils are evidence of evolution because the word transitional itself assumes evolution is happening. Even saying that evolution predicts intermediate forms and intermediate forms exist, therefore evolution must be true, well, that's using the affirming the consequent fallacy discussed back in episode 47. Ultimately, a little biblical critical thinking reveals that, far from being proof of evolution, intermediate-looking fossils often cause problems for evolution, yet are consistent with biblical interpretations. For more on how to think critically about any faith-challenging message, you can access my other CT scan episodes packed with tactics, tips, and tools that helped me as a Christian student at Secular University. Thank you for watching. Hey, it's Patricia. Just wanted to let you know that if you like these videos, are on board to share the message of biblical authority, and want to give, you're welcome to help Answers in Genesis produce more content like this and equip more people to defend their faith by making a one-time donation or becoming a monthly supporter by clicking the link below. Thanks so much.